Hello everybody, welcome to Shaders Monthly. Today we talk about what are shaders. In computer graphics, rendering is a process of converting a mathematical scene description into an output image. Shaders are computer programs that tell the computer how to render the scene. Often, but not always, shaders are executed in parallel and often on a special piece of hardware in your computer called the GPU, short for Graphics Processing Unit. Shader programming is not necessarily complicated. I'm sure that at the end of this video, you will have succeeded in programming your first shader. Often different rendering pipelines are created with very different goals. They use different shader types, conventions, and different shader languages. For example, there are many different game engines for real-time processing, and each one might have a custom shader definition for its special rendering pipeline. The same is true for offline rendering pipelines for movie productions, where each company defines its own interface. Therefore, I recommend starting learning shader programming by working with a standardized rendering pipeline, such as the OpenGL pipeline. Once you have learned the basics of the OpenGL pipeline and its shading language, which is called GLSL, you will see that many other rendering pipelines use similar concepts. Input to the OpenGL pipeline are 3D meshes that are represented as a collection of triangles. Each triangle is defined by 3 vertices. Each vertex has a position x, y, z in 3D space. Furthermore, each vertex might have additional attributes that can be freely defined. Most applications provide at least a per vertex surface normal direction and a per vertex texture coordinate. The first shader that is applied to the mesh is the vertex shader. It is executed for every vertex of the input mesh. The task of the vertex shader is to perform per vertex operations. For example, the transformation of each vertex from the local coordinate system of the mesh into the coordinate system of the camera, as well as the projection into the image plane of the camera. The result of this process are 2D vertices in the image plane. For triangles, the OpenGL pipeline uses 3 2D vertices to generate a 2D triangle primitive. But you can also configure the pipeline to generate other primitives, for example, a quad from 4 vertices as shown here, or a line from 2 vertices, or a point from 1 vertex. Next, the task of the rasterizer hardware inside the GPU is to compute which pixels in the output image are covered by each primitive. For each pixel, a fragment shader is executed. The task of the fragment shader is to perform per pixel operations, which is why it is also called pixel shader. The output of the fragment shader is a color that is assigned to the corresponding pixel of the output image. The output image is also called frame buffer. But before a color is written to the frame buffer, the fragment must pass several tests. Most importantly, if the depth test is enabled, the color is only written to the frame buffer if the current fragment is closer to the camera than previous fragments written to the same pixel location. Finally, when all primitives are rasterized, the frame buffer contains the image that is displayed on the screen. The rasterization approach is one way to generate 3D graphics. Another popular approach is ray tracing, which we will certainly cover at some later point. Now let's implement our first shader. To this end, I use a shader editor provided by the GSN Composer website at gsn-lib.org. The GSN Composer is a web-based tool that I created especially for teaching shader programming, and it makes it simple to provide input data for our shaders. But you can also use any other shader editor or text editor that you like. We are going to write pure OpenGL GLSL code, which you can use everywhere. In the video description, you can find links to download examples for the programming language C++ and Java that run exactly the same GLSL shader code that we are going to create now with the GSN Composer. In the GSN Composer interface, click on the Create button. In the dialog, navigate to 3D, Compute, Plugin, Shader. Several nodes are created in the graph area. Select the created blue shader plugin node and click on the Edit Code button. This dialog is the shader editor of the GSN Composer. In the top section, you can define the vertex shader, and in the bottom section, the fragment shader. Let's delete the default shader source in both sections and start from scratch. This line defines the GLSL version to be 3.0. The next line sets the precision of floating point operations to high. Next, we define the input to our vertex shader, in_vec3_position. This tells the shader that we want to use a vertex attribute called position, which is a 3-vector with an x, y, z coordinate. When the vertex shader is executed in parallel on the GPU for each input vertex of the mesh, this variable is set accordingly for each vertex. Void main brackets curly brackets. This is the main function which is executed for each input vertex. Here you can define local variables, for example scalar values, such as an integer. Int a equals 42. Or a floating point value, float b equals 0. There are also integer vectors, such as ivec3c equals ivec3 1, 2, 3, semicolon. Or floating point vectors, such as vec3p equals vec3 1.4, 2.6, 3.1. Every vertex shader has a predefined compulsory output variable called glPosition. Next, we could, for example, assign our input position to the variable p. vec3p equals position. glPosition is a vec4 variable with four components. Later, in the OpenGL pipeline, during an operation called perspective division, within the per vertex post-processing step, the x, y, and z components are divided by the fourth component. Consequently, if we want the perspective division to not affect the vertex position, we have to set the fourth component to 1. Px, Py, Pz, 1. We can write the same code in a more compact way by putting the 3-vector position directly into glPosition. In summary, this is probably the most simple vertex shader possible. It does almost nothing. It just passes the position of every vertex further down the pipeline. Let us now write the fragment shader. Again, we define the GLSL version. And we set the precision of floating point operations to high. Next, we define the name of the output variable for our fragment shader. Out vec4 outColor. Void main brackets curly brackets outColor equals vec4. This is the main function which is called in parallel by the rasterizer for each fragment. Its task is to assign a color to the corresponding fragment, which is achieved by setting the outColor variable to a 4-vector. The first three components of the vector correspond to the red, green, and blue values of the additive RGB color model. The values are in range 0 to 1. The fourth component is the alpha channel, which defines the degree of opacity. A value of 0 means fully transparent, and a value of 1 is fully opaque. For example, if we want the output pixel to be red and opaque, 1, 0, 0, 1. Full red, no green, no blue, fully opaque. Now let's try if this combination of vertex and fragment shader compiles by clicking on the check code button. No, something is wrong. We forgot the semicolon. Now it should work. Now we have to provide an input mesh to our shader. Close the shader editor. Click on the Create button and select 3D, Compute, Generate, Triangle. In the visual programming interface of the GSN Composer, green nodes represent data and blue nodes are compute nodes. Blue compute nodes and green data nodes need to alternate in the graph. Consequently, we have to connect the green data node containing the triangle data to the blue shader node, which performs the computation. Then we press the play button to see what we have created. Hooray! We have rendered our first triangle. Now let's select a more interesting 3D mesh. Click on the Create button and select 3D, Compute, Generate, Torus Knot. We connect the green Torus Knot data node to the blue shader compute node. Well, the Torus Knot is too large. Let's make it smaller. To this end, we open the shader code and scale the vertex position by 0.5. Apply code. But it would be more convenient to change the scaling parameter without editing the shader code. This can be achieved by defining a uniform variable. A uniform variable is a constant during a rendering call, which means that the same value is applied to all vertices of a rendering call. However, we can change the value between rendering calls. For example, we can change it for every rendered frame. While variables with the uniform qualifier are constant for all vertices, variables with the in qualifier change for every vertex. For example, if we would like to access the per vertex normal direction, we could write in vec3 normal. To access the normal information in the fragment shader, we have to define an out variable in the vertex shader, out vec3 interpolated normal. We call this variable interpolated normal because the rasterizer will generate interpolated values for each fragment of the primitive. In the main function of the vertex shader, we type interpolated normal equals normal. Next, in the fragment shader, we add the in variable in vec3 interpolated normal. Now, let's use the interpolated normal as the output RGB color, vec4 interpolated normal 1. Apply code. Looks interesting, but makes sense. A normal pointing in the x direction is now represented by a red color, y direction as a green color, and z direction should be a blue color. But blue does not show up here because the z values are all negative for the current projection. Great, this was not so hard. If you want to export your shader to a C++ or Java project, you can click on the Export Code button. That's it for today. Links and source code are provided in the video description. If you have any questions, please contact me. See you at the next episode of Shaders Monthly.